This podcast is brought to you by LMU Munich.
This is our last talk before lunch. You know, we have before us Peter Hoffmann. He's a senior software engineer at Blue Yonder. His topic for this talk is infrastructure as Python code, deploying your web services on Microsoft Azure. Please make him welcome.
So thanks for the introduction. Yes, my name is Peter Hoffmann. I'm a senior software engineer at Blue Yonder. We develop machine learning algorithms, mostly in the retail sector. So for our customers, we try to predict sales, to do implement replenishment on top of it, or we do dynamic pricing. Here are my contact information. If you have any questions after the talk, just Twitter to me. And I'm going to publish the slides on GitHub at our company account. So maybe before we start, let's have a small poll. Who thinks Microsoft is a really cool company that understands open source and pushes Python development? So, yeah, one, two people. To be honest, once our CTO decided, okay, we'll move to the cloud and it's going to be Azure, I wasn't that excited either. I've been a Linux guy for more than 25 years and always thought about Microsoft, okay, these are the bad guys. So we did on AWS a demo implementation of our software stack. Everything worked out, and I thought, okay, it's going to be AWS, and everything's going to be fine. In the end of the day, it was Azure, and I really had to learn lots of things have changed. They really get open source better, maybe not perfect now, and they really handle Python as a first class citizens in their architecture. So that was what I learned the last half year. I've been responsible to move our stack from dedicated hardware, we had racks in data centers, to Azure. We are in the middle of it now. After half a year, we managed to have our whole platform running in parallel mode, and I think it will take us another half year to really get everything over to the cloud. So what is Microsoft Azure? So you see a screenshot of the portal. It's a cloud infrastructure provider. So Microsoft does all the hardware stuff for you. And to some extent, it's also a managed service provider. So they do not only provide the basic services like networking, computing, storage, but you can also get higher level services like database systems. They have a managed Postgres cluster. They have their own database systems. You can even get a full Hadoop stack with Spark included and HDFS managed for you with a simple click. We discovered going to the cloud is not only about exchanging your servers against some cloud deployment. It's also some kind of change in your company culture, because we had a dedicated ops team that was responsible to handle all the hardware stuff. Now everybody can do it by himself, more or less. You can get storage, you can get computation, and all the networking stuff just via APIs or defined in some templates. So this was one of the first learnings we had. You really have to get everyone on board, because you have to change the way of thinking. Azure, I think, went public in 2010. Now they even have two versions on how you deploy stuff. The classic mode, I'm not going to talk about this. And the newer mode, that's the Azure Resource Management mode. So everything on Azure is about resource providers. So example, for the networking stuff, you have a resource provider which provides you with an API, with a REST API, where you can build your network stuff, your subnetting, the security rules and all the stuff. The same for storage and for computation and for the higher level services. So these providers all have the same kind of API. It's the Azure Resource Manager API. And you can talk to this API with different tools. Of course, you have seen the portal. You can deploy everything via click and drop via the portal. But for us doing DevOps, that's not an option because it's not reproducible. It's different, difficult to have an A and a B system to do continuous deployment and testing and all the stuff. So you somehow have to automate all the stuff. Of course, the first thing that Microsoft supports is their own PowerShell. But as far as I know, it only runs on Windows, and it wasn't an option for us. So we had a look at the other options. The big one is the ARM templates. So you define your infrastructure in a declarative way, and the Azure managed service takes care of deploying all the stuff and talking to the REST API. And then there's a Python wrapper to the REST API. And on top of it, you can talk to the services via the Azure command line client, which is implemented in Python 2, and use Ansible to deploy your stuff. So the ARM templates are an imperative way, a declarative way, so you define what you want to have deployed, commit this to the deployer manager, and he takes care that every resource is deployed like defined in the template. If you use the Azure CLI or Ansible, it's more an imperative way. So you tell deploy this machine or take this machine down. So it's kind of different deployment modes. What is really nice that Microsoft uses Swagger. That's an IP documentation system. It's even, I think, implemented in Python 2 to describe all their API endpoints, and based on the Swagger definitions, they generate the client APIs. So you always get the same features in your Python API than they have for their other APIs, like the PowerShell one or the C# one. And they use JSON schema to define all their payload. We'll see later what this means. So the basic deployment concept in Azure are resource groups. They are a container for multiple resources. Each resource belongs to one resource group and only one resource groups. In Azure, you have the concept, or it's the same in AWS, of different regions, but your resource groups can span different regions, and you can have different resources inside your resource group. On the left side, it's a typical deployment from us. It's a deployment of a DevPy server. That's a kind of private PyPy server developed by Holger Krekel. We use it internally to store all our Python artifacts and deploy from there so that we are not dependent on external services. What you can see here are some different resources we have deployed. So that's an availability set with two virtual machines. So if one machine goes down or goes into maintenance, the server still is up because the second one can handle the load, and we have put everything behind a load balancer. So this whole infrastructure is defined in a template, and the deployment makes sure that it's executed on Azure and all the resources are deployed. You could put all your resources from your whole platform into one resource group. That would work probably fine, but it's not a good idea. So you should take resource groups to group things together which share the same life cycle. So for example, if you have front-end and back-end servers and maybe database servers, you don't want to update or change them all at once, but maybe just change your front-end servers or just change your back-end servers. This makes life much easier, and you can even do some kind of access control based on the resource groups. So maybe only your front-end guys could deploy the front-end servers, and the networking guys can deploy the networking stuff. So the other platform includes a managed Active Directory. That's an LDAP server where you can have groups and people and permissions. And all this role-based access controls applies to the resource groups. So you can really define what people can do what with resource groups. Can they only see what's inside the resource group? Can they deploy resource groups? Or even can they create new resource groups? When we started moving our software to Azure, we didn't think that much about this. We just said, okay, everybody in the whole team can do everything. Probably that's not the best idea. As you have seen, I accidentally just deployed some resource group, which I shouldn't even deploy because it was not my business. I did it anyway. I changed something and nuked the storage account. All the data was gone. So this wasn't a big deal because it was just a test account. But in the end of the day, it should have never been happened because it wasn't my business and I shouldn't have the permission to deploy this resource group. So I think it's important from the beginning, think about security, think about who should deploy what, and group your stuff in resource groups. What we do now, even on each virtual machine, you have the storage accounts, which are bound to the virtual machine, where all the data lives. We even separate these two ones, so the storage resource groups are protected. Nobody can delete all the stuff. You can only manage the compute part of virtual machines. So it's even safe to discard one virtual machine because the data will still be there because it's in a different resource group. So how do we deploy stuff? The basic or the most used concept is the Azure Resource Management Templates. The templates are a declarative JSON-based description of the desired state that you want to have your infrastructure in. And the Azure Resource Manager takes care of parallel provisioning and has features like rollback and all the stuff. So here you see in the bottom a simple command line call, how you deploy a resource group, and you just have to provide a template name. That's a file, JSON, I'll show you later. And once the command is finished, all your infrastructure is up and running. You can have two different deployment modes. The one is complete and the other one is incremental. A complete deployment means Azure takes your template, looks at all the resources, deploys all the resources, but additionally deletes all the resources that you have not defined in your template. If you just do an incremental deployment, that's sometimes a little bit safer because you don't delete stuff. It will only add the resources that you have deployed or that you have added in your template additionally. But we really prefer the complete deployment because we want to have the declarative definition of our stack on Azure, and we want that the same that we have in the template is deployed and nothing more and nothing less. So what does an ARM template look like? That's the minimal JSON that you need to deploy something. So everything in the Azure resource template is bound to a schema. They use the JSON schema, so you have always say which schema you want to use for your template. You can, of course, define the resources that you want to deploy. You can have a parameters file where you can inject external parameters into your resource template. This works really nice if you want to have a staging area where you want to deploy the same infrastructure, but maybe with different IP addresses or maybe smaller database sizes. So you can have two parameters files, one for production, one for development, but use the same template to deploy your stuff. And then you can use a variable section that's variables that you can define and use inside your template. And you can have an output sections where you can, once the template is deployed, output different implementation, output some variables or stuff you're interested about the deployment. Microsoft has open sourced all the JSON schemas on GitHub. That's quite interesting to look into it, and we even started to implement a Python library that was generated on top of these schema definitions. So now let's deploy something real. So we want to have a storage account. Again, you deploy a resource in this resource hash, and you have to provide an API version. You have to say which deployment you want to do. That's Microsoft Storage or storage account. You have to name it. You have to tell Azure in which location you want to deploy it. And you can provide some extra information, like what kind of storage account do you want to have. So should all the storage be just local to the data center, or redundant to different data centers, or even redundant to different regions? Of course, more redundancy is more expensive. Yeah, that's things you can define in your template. One interesting thing that we quite use extensively is applying tags to resources. So you can provide up to 250 tags for each resource, and you could use the tags afterwards in billing, in the Ansible stuff I'll show later. So that really helps keeping a track of all your resources you have deployed. Because as soon as you start bigger, it's not that easy always to know why is this machine deployed and who has deployed it. So use tags. This will help you afterwards very much. One thing they invented, and I'm not that happy about it, but you need it, is these template functions. So you can see here in the name, if a value of a dict starts with square brackets, you have some kind of inside templating language. So you can call functions that are evaluated during the deployment, and you can somehow dynamically generate stuff. I find it pretty hard to read this stuff and even to write it, but sometimes it's the only way to get things done. For example, storage account share a global namespace all over Azure. So if I would have the name, I don't know, Python, that's probably already taken by someone else. So what you do here, you say, okay, generate me a Unix string that's a hash from your resource group ID, and then you can be pretty sure that only this hash is only taken by you. Another pattern we quite use often is, okay, we want to deploy the storage account in the same resource group as we deploy the template. So you can use this resource group function and call the location property, and then it will always be this location where you deploy the template. So when you deploy it in West Europe, it's that this the storage account is in West Europe 2. If you deploy it in North Europe, it will be in North Europe 2. There are basic template functions for array, for working with arrays, like first get the index, get the length of an array. You have numeric functions, add, multiply, divide. And you have some string functions where you can get a substring of something. You can decode base for S64. You have this Unix string function or replace. So there are much more functions. I don't really like them, but you have to use them to get things done. When you want to use some information multiple times in your template, it's probably a good idea to refactor the variable out to the variable section. So now we define a storage account name in the variable sections. We can use the template function variables to access this property. And for example, if we now deploy an additional virtual machine where we want to reuse the storage account, we can use the same variable, so it helps you to get the template a little bit cleaner. Okay, that's probably too small, but you also have the output section. So, as I said, the Unix string from your resource ID is calculated when you deploy your template to Azure, so you would be probably interested, what's the real name of this storage account? So you can define an output, and dump out the value of the storage account name. And then once you deploy the stuff, you get an output section in JSON format, which really shows you, okay, this storage account, this is the naming, it's some hash value, and then you can use it in other scripts. Template parameters, you have to define them in the parameter sections, use them probably in the same way as the variables, so you have the template function parameters address space, and then you can inject the parameters with another file on deployment, so you can deploy the same templates with different parameters for different staging areas. So that's what we have here. We have a simple parameters file where you write down some values for your parameters, and then you deploy the templates with the other command and tell it, okay, use this parameters files, and so you can deploy different stuff in different staging areas with different parameters. It's quite important to do it this way because if you want to test a template, you probably want to test the same template you will deploy later on production. So using the parameters file is quite a nice way to achieve this. One thing we also learned, protect your sensitive data. So do not include passwords for the initial machine setup or stuff like that into your template parameters. Use the secure string and secure objects, or use the Azure Key Vault secrets where you can have secrets stored in Azure and just access them via a unique name, and then on deployment the secret will be injected into your template and you nowhere in your source control you have passwords. What we are seeing, Azure templates are much more complex than simple JSON files, so you have the schema for everything. You have content versioning, you have these parameters and variables, you have the inline template expressions, you have outputs, and you can even link templates together so that you have a base template which uses other templates on deployment time. So this soon gets quite complex, and you really have to look about it. Okay, I'll now show you a little bit about the Azure command line. Microsoft has implemented. They have an Azure CLI version 1. This was implemented in Node.js, but they got the feedback that the developers, mainly on the Linux systems and even on the Mac systems, weren't too happy with this because it doesn't feel like a Linux command line client. So they re-implemented all the stuff in Python. It has auto-completion. It supports different output formats. You can query the output via James Pass, and it's, as I said earlier, generated from the Swagger definition, so you don't, you act as a first, you are supported like the other command line clients too, and it's also published on GitHub. So a simple query, Azure, show me all the storage accounts from this resource group, it dumps you out a JSON. What I really like, JSON output is fine. You could tools like JQ to really fiddle out stuff from it, but sometimes it's easier to use grep and all the command line clients that you know about in Linux, so you can change the output format to a tabular format or even a CSV format, and then you can use the output to work with the other Linux tools. I've looked at the source code. They really had a nice implementation. So they have this object tree, and they have written different output handlers. The upper one uses the tabulate Python library. The TSV input uses the standard CSV formatter, and they manage to output all the stuff. So that's really a nice feature. Via the James Pass query language, you can query on the object tree and say, for example, okay, I just want the accounts where the SKU name is standard ARGs, that means that is on different data centers, and please only dump out the name and the primarily endpoint for the blob storage, and then you get a list, a JSON list of the values. You could also use the other output formatter to even get a table or a CSV output, and then you can work from this part on with the other tools. In the beginning, we only use template and the command line client to deploy stuff or to provision stuff. But afterwards, our whole stack is in Ansible, where we really deploy our services. So we had also a look at the Azure client for Azure, the Ansible client for Azure. So there are some Azure RR for resource management modules, which are now inside the Ansible distribution. You can mostly do three tasks. The one is deploy your templates with Azure. So you basically, instead of using the command line client, you use Ansible to deploy the templates. There are even some modules, mostly for computation, for storage, and for networking, where you can define your resources in an Ansible way. And there's a dynamic inventory script that can act as a bridge to your deployment later on. I'll tell you about in a minute. So the template deployment, it's not that fancy. You just have to provide a template file, and then the Ansible call will deploy everything that's in the template file. It will even use the same API in the backend as the command line client. You can also define the deployment mode, complete incremental, and using the state, you can say, okay, I want to have this template or this resources pre-send or upsend. If you say upsend, it will delete all the stuff. You can not only provide an extra file, JSON file with resources, but you can type down the same stuff you have in the JSON file now in YAML format inline. So you define the same resources inline storage account, and it will make this the same deployment. It's sometimes this helps a little bit more because if you have some variables defined in Ansible already, you can use these variables here. In the resource definition, so this brings Ansible and the Azure templates a little bit together. They have some special modules which you can use to really deploy resources the Ansible way, networking, virtual machines, and storage. The Azure has more than 100 resource providers, and the only support is here for 10 in the Ansible modules. So that's rather a limited way you can use. The deployment doesn't look that different to the template deploy. Just the values and the keys are named a little bit different. And yeah.
Just like a Swagger file.
Hmm?
It looks almost the same as Swagger file for the
India. Yeah, probably. What we use extensively, so we tag all our resources, and then you have the Azure MPI script, which is a dynamic inventory. So when you call it, the script will give you back for all your resources, in which group are they, which role have they, which tag is applied to them, and then you can use this information in your normal Ansible deployments to restrict stuff and use it there without to duplicate all the definitions. What we have seen, there are only a limited list of resources which you can use with the Azure Ansible RM modules. It does not work with the latest Azure client libraries, so that was a no-go for us. For simple tasks like provisioning network and compute, it's okay. If you want to use managed services, there's no support yet. We like the dynamic inventory, and we are using the template deployment and instrumenting it with parameters from Ansible. So this was an overview how you get your infrastructure into Azure. What we have seen, we quite like Azure. I think they are still behind WAVS, but they are catching on some parts like networking. I think they are even better than AWS because they could learn from some mistakes that AWS has made. Still, Microsoft is not yet the coolest company. Still, they are no open source company. But at least what I've seen, they are really pushing Python on lots of their tool stacks. So that's nice for me, and I think that's nice for the Python community. So thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Peter. While we take questions now, though our time has really been eating into, just take one question, then go for lunch. Okay, please, go ahead.
What was the main reason for deciding for Azure? Was it being ahead in the network management?
No, at the end of the day, it was business reasons. So we talked to AWS and Azure, and we had the feeling the Azure guys much more wanted us to have on their platform. I think AWS is still a little more settled. They don't need new customers that much. Azure needs them. And we had a much better feeling with them. So, yeah.
Also the support.
Okay, I can't compare it because we had no professional support from AWS. But until now, it's quite... Sometimes you have to escalate, but once you have escalated and got beyond the call center somewhere in the world, that's really, really good.
All right, thank you, Peter. You can ask if you have other questions, see him and ask him personally.
See him around, speak to me.
All right.
Okay.
All right, thank you. See you back at 1500 hours for